in the city's case, Mr. DeRocher, just call you next week.
The city calls Richard Robiscus.
Can you use your license?
Here, put your license with us.
Oh, sure.
First child.
That's nothing, brother.
Thank you.
Yes, raise your right hand. You solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth.
I do.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Would you please state and spell your full name for the record, please?
Sure. Richard Allen Robiscus. It's, can you spell the first name or just the last name?
Just the last name, I think, is fine.
Yeah, it's W-E-R-B-I-S-K-I-S.
Mr. Robiscus, are you employed by the city of Deland?
Yes, I am.
What is your position with the city of Deland?
I'm the community development director.
And what does a community development director do in the city of Deland?
I oversee all development services for the city, including planning, building, code enforcement, economic development, and occasionally the fire marshal.
And in that role, do you have access to zoning and enforcement types of records, sir?
Yes.
Including planning records, building records, that type of stuff?
Yes.
I have an exhibit that was not part of the book that we just added. I'd like to approach if that's okay.
Until you show it to Mr. Wilson, unless he already has it.
No, sir.
Okay.
This was our effort to avoid the site visits. This is our effort to avoid the site visits. This is kind of a compromise that I did to say.
Okay. Oh, okay, thank you.
Mr. Robiscus, I'm showing you what we're going to mark for the moment as City Exhibit 17. Sir, do you recognize this document?
Yes, I do.
And how do you recognize this document?
It is a document I created this afternoon at approximately 12:30 p.m.
Okay, and can you please tell me what this document represents or depicts, sir?
It represents the distance between West New York Avenue and its intersection with South Woodland and 208 North Woodland Avenue.
Okay, and where does this record come from, sir?
It is derived from the Volusia County appraiser's records.
Okay, so is this an official Volusia County record, sir?
To the best of my knowledge, yes.
Okay, and to the best of your knowledge, is this an accurate depiction of the distance between the intersection at New York Avenue and 208 Woodland Avenue, sir?
It's not survey quality, but it is an accurate depiction, I would say within 5 to 10 feet in terms of looking at distance.
At this time, I'd like to move this, which marked as City Exhibit 17, into evidence.
Our objection is to, well, relevancy, number one, and second, this was never a part of any of the IA report provided to this officer. As you just heard on the cross, there was some testimony or some statements made by the investigator as to him driving, but this is all something you just heard that has just been created today. So our objection would be that it was not a part of the IA packet that this officer ever received. It's prejudicial, and it's something literally that was just created today that we're just getting to see for the first time.
Overruled, I'll accept it into evidence for what it is. reserves, but I'll accept it consistent with what I said in my opening, that I'm going to lean toward inclusiveness of all presented evidence. I understand it was created today. And I give you a point, Mr. Wilson, but I'm going to accept it in the evidence in the way you deserve. So we'll mark this as City Exhibit 17 to add it to the city's exhibit.
We just have a handful more questions, actually, with respect to a similar document. I'll show Mr. Wilson right now. It's going to be the same type of job. Mr. Viscus, do you recognize this document?
Yes.
And what do you recognize this document?
It is a similar document that I created at approximately the same time, utilizing the Volusia County Appraisers records, indicating the distance between West Highway Avenue and its intersection with Woodland, and also 208 North Woodland.
No further questions for this witness. I apologize. This time I'd like to move this into evidence as the city's Exhibit 18.
Same objections.
And overruled for the same reasons, we'll accept the second map into evidence as city exhibit number 18. But you have no more questions for the witness about these maps?
About these maps or in general, sir.
Mr. Wilson, meet your witness.
Okay. Mr. Wurbiscus, am I pronouncing it correctly?
Yes, you are, sir.
Mr. Wurbiscus, how long have you been at the city, the land?
Employed a little over 5 years.
Okay. So 2016?
August of 2016.
Are you holding the same position today that you held back in January of 19? Almost 3 years ago?
Yes, I am.
Exact same position?
Community Development Director, correct.
And you were asked to create these two documents today, correct?
That is correct.
How long did it take you to do that?
Approximately 10 minutes. I was having some computer issues with my work computer. Okay.
So even with computer issues, you were able to produce these in 10 minutes?
Yes.
Do you have any reason to know why the Internal Affairs Department of this police department couldn't have contacted you back in January or February of 2019 to produce these same two documents?
I do not generally create these documents, and I'm not sure if they would have contacted me directly. They may have contacted one of my staff members or our GIS department.
Do you have any knowledge of being contacted in 2019 to prepare something similar to what we're seeing here today for the first time?
I have no knowledge of that, no.
If there was a request by someone in the internal affairs section of the police department to create something like this, would you have kept a record of that?
If there was an email request, yes. If it was a verbal request, then I may not have retained record of that.
You know an investigative lieutenant by the name of Juan Milan?
Name is not familiar to me.
Do you have any independent recollection as you sit here today, Internal Affairs Investigator Juan Milan ever picking up the phone, emailing you, texting you, walking to your office, in any way, shape, or form communicating with you, a request to create anything like what we're looking at here today?
I have no recollection of any of that.
How about, you know the man seated over there in the police uniform, right? That's the police chief?
Yes, sir.
He's here in his representative capacity representing the entire department today. Are you aware of that?
I'm not aware of what these proceedings really involve. Okay.
You're just here because you were asked to produce something today, and you were asked on the fly to come testify, weren't you?
I'm not sure if I've been classified as being on the fly, but yes, I was requested to produce a document.
Did you know before today you were going to testify?
No.
You learned sometime. We're at 3:15, sometime between 9:15 and the last 6 hours you were going to testify today, correct?
Correct.
And you were asked to put something together and you did it in 10 minutes? One thing that Mr. DeRosiers did not ask you about is, look at Exhibit 17 for a moment. There's an entry on the middle of the page in black writing, length 796.7 feet. Is that something that you typed on there, sir?
No, sir.
Okay. Do you know how that, you know, what that numerical representation means and who it came from?
It is produced by the computer itself, representing the start and stop point of the green line.
Okay. And what is your experience, you know, you've been with the city 5 years, 5.5 years almost. This is a print, I mean, this, you're using a piece of equipment that spits out a diagram based on data that you put in, that you input, correct?
I do not input any of the data. I just put in the starting and stopping points of the measurements I'm seeking.
Okay. And how do we know that these are accurate measurements, that this length 796.7 feet? How do we know that? How do we verify that?
In order to verify, you need to contact the Volusia County Appraiser's Office.
Okay, and you're not with the Volusia County Appraiser's Office, right?
No, sir.
You're with Community Development, is that correct?
I am the Community Development Director for the City of Deland.
Same question on Exhibit 18, this length of 1,451.8 feet. Is that something you didn't enter, but it results when you put in the starting point and end point?
That is correct, similar to other geographic information system software.
Okay. So something like a MapQuest or something, you could put two points and it could tell you in miles or feet or kilometers, the distance, correct?
I would say yes.
Okay. And you mentioned 208. Where is 208? Did you indicate the bar location called the Boulevard on here?
I'm not familiar with the name.
Okay.
The addresses are in red as noted on the...
Okay.
Above the dots themselves.
And you're saying it's 208 is the location that you were asked to put as an endpoint, is that correct?
That is correct.
Is it from point to point is measured from the middle of the street, correct? Not a as the crow flies, as they say, not a straight shot if you're looking off the road at something.
This would be a straight point from beginning to end. I can't say it's directly within the center line. That is purely determined by my starting and stopping.
Okay.
For the measurement.
Just one last little area to ask you about. Did the city have equipment? Obviously, it had this equipment back in January of 2019 to produce something like this, correct?
Our geographic information system was operational at that time period, yes.
And did the city also have, to your knowledge, the ability to, if you have any knowledge of this, sir, GPS capability to pinpoint city vehicles in
I'm
one location for another?
Our capabilities of using GPS on vehicles.
Okay. And other than today being asked to testify in this arbitration proceeding and provide these two documents that have been created today, again, are you aware of any, have you ever seen any communication made to your department to assist in providing any sort of calculation between two points for an internal affairs case?
No, and that would not be brought to my attention unless a team member was seeking permit, whether they needed my permission to conduct that.
All right, I have nothing further.
Nothing from me.
Okay.
Sir, I don't have any questions either. Thank you for coming to our hearing. You're excused.
Thank you.
Thank you, sirs.
Are you ready for the next witness?
Who's your next witness?
We're going to call Lieutenant Juan Milan. It's going to take a few minutes, so that Mark Haber can get.
Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Good afternoon, Lieutenant Milan.
Good afternoon.
Could you please state your name and rank for the record?
Juan Milan, Lieutenant.
And you understand that you're here to testify today in an arbitration proceeding that's been brought by the union former officer Leslie Goins?
Yes.
And you understand that he's challenging his termination of employment from the Atlanta Police Department? Lieutenant Milan, how long have you worked for the Atlanta Police Department?
19 years.
Okay, and how long have you been in law enforcement?
How long?
I'm sorry, I think you said 19 years?
Yes.
19 years with the city of Atlanta?
Yes.
Yes.
You might need to speak up a little. I got these plexiglass things
around me.
Just so I can hear. I don't want to interrupt and stop the flow. So.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And how long have you been in law enforcement, sir?
19.
Your entire law enforcement career has been with this agency, sir?
That's correct.
And where are you currently assigned to the Atlanta Police Department?
Internal affairs.
What other roles have you held here in the Atlanta Police Department?
Been a patrol officer, a narcotics officer, traffic, homicide investigator, community service, and now internal affairs.
So, are there any positions you have been held here?
Other than the canine, yes, sir.
Okay. And how long have you been in the role of internal affairs investigator?
3 years.
Did you have any previous experience in IA prior to that?
I do not.
Okay. How many investigators are in internal affairs?
Internal affairs right now?
Yes.
At the time that this incident took place?
Well, let's start right now.
Two.
Okay. And so it's yourself and who else?
Reserve Officer Vasquez.
And then what about as of February of 2019, do you recall how many investigators were in the internal affairs department?
Just one.
And that one would be you, sir?
That would be me.
What is the reporting structure in the internal affairs department?
Reporting structure as far as?
For internal affairs. Do you have a supervisor in internal affairs?
I do.
Okay. And who is that?
That would be, at the time, was Deputy Chief Gary Mack.
Okay. And so is it, in general, the deputy chief is the supervisor over internal affairs?
Yes.
Is that still the case today?
It is.
And Gary Batten is no longer the deputy chief of police?
That's correct.
He retired, sir?
Yes, he did.
Who's the current deputy chief of police?
Adam Kishart.
And Deputy Chief Kishart is your supervisor currently in internal affairs?
That's correct.
Okay. I want to make sure I understand how this works. Does the deputy chief conduct any of the investigations by himself?
No.
What about the chief of police?
He does not.
Okay. Do either one of them write the final internal affairs reports?
No, sir.
So, do you conduct the investigation?
Yes.
and you write the reports?
That's correct.
Okay, so I want to make sure that I understand, and I can say this because my boss isn't here, but in my world, the associate, that's me, does the bulk of the work, does the first draft, written work product, and then when I feel comfortable, or at least I feel comfortable, I think I feel comfortable, I then turn everything over to a partner, and the partner will review my work, sometimes scribble out 90% of it and send it back to me and rewrite it and follow up on things. Is that how it works for you, sir?
It is.
Okay. And you said you've been the internal affairs investigator since when, sir?
2 years, since 2019.
Okay, so that would be right around the time that the internal affairs investigation for Mr. Goins began?
That's correct.
Do you recall approximately when that was?
September of 2018 is when I actually got transferred from community services to internal affairs.
Oh, okay. Okay. Did you conduct the internal affairs investigation with respect to Mr. Goins?
I did.
Was he the only officer that was involved in that investigation?
No.
I guess I'll ask this a different way. Was he the only officer that was the subject of that investigation?
No.
Okay. And who else was?
Officer. At the time, officer.
Okay. And both of them were ultimately terminated following the internal affairs investigation?
That's correct.
I'm going, sir, to, if you could grab the black book, I'm going to turn your attention to tab 5. Sir, do you recognize this document?
I do.
And what do you recognize this document?
Internal affairs investigation that I have conducted.
And is this the report that you prepared at the end of that investigation, sir?
That's correct.
At this time, I'd like to move City Exhibit 5 into evidence of internal affairs investigation report.
No objection other than the fact that I don't know if there's a later version. Since we just got the city's exhibits this morning, this one's not signed on page 21.
No, we don't have to sign on that.
Okay. If they don't have the signed one, I just want to note that for the record that maybe there's a signed one, but if not, then no objection.
Okay. So no objection. Exhibit 5 in the city's notebook is submitted as evidence as exhibit 5.
Lieutenant Ballon, can you actually also turn to tab 14 in the city's note? You recognize this document, sir?
I do.
Is this the document that initiated that internal affairs investigation that you conducted?
It is.
And did Chief Jason Humberger order this investigation?
Correct.
Do you know why Chief Humberger ordered this investigation?
Yes. We received a letter from Donald Dempsey's office basically saying to preserve all evidence.
Okay. Donald Dempsey was an attorney representing Mr. Staff. Okay. So the city received a letter, document preservation letter, you said?
Correct.
And after that point is when the internal affairs investigation was ordered to be conducted?
Correct.
This time I'd like to move City Exhibit 14 into evidence.
Is it 14 or 4?
It was 14, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's right. Probably my voice.
Mr. Wilson, any objection to 14 coming into evidence?
It looks like no objection. There may be two pages behind tab 14. Is that two citizen complaints that look identical? Is there supposed to be? I mean, that's fine.
Okay. I guess I'll ask you if you recognize both of those documents, sir. The first two pages, both asking for ordering an investigation.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this comes in as 14.
And for the record, in my notebook of Exhibit 14, I have two letters that the defendant has testified about, but there's a few more documents that I did as well. So all of 14 is coming in, right?
Yes.
And no objection to the letter and the announcement of no information.
Okay. So hearing no objection to all the exhibits under Cities Tab 14, all of those documents are admitted into evidence.
So it's on Mr. Dempsey, we were just talking about, was the attorney that was representing Mr. Staff, correct?
Yes, sir.
And he sent document preservation letters to the city with respect to the arrest of Mr. Staff.
Correct.
And then following that, receipt of that letter was when the internal affairs investigation was ordered.
Correct.
And it was Chief Allmerger who ordered the investigation to be conducted?
Yes.
Okay. Sir, did you ultimately conduct an internal affairs investigation?
I did.
Do you have to notify the subject that they're under investigation?
I do.
Okay. Could you turn to tab 4, please, of the city's book? Sir, do you recognize this document?
I do.
Do you recognize this document to be the document notifying Mr. Goins that he was the subject of an internal affairs investigation?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you could, sir, could you please flip to the fifth page within that that exhibit at tab 4? All right, you see that document, sir?
I do.
It's entitled Goins Police Department Police Officer Bill of Rights.
Yes.
What is this?
Hang on, let me catch up with you.
Sure.
You're on the fifth page in, the Land Police Department, Police Officers, Bill of Rights?
Yes, Mr. Archer.
Thank you.
So this is the Law Enforcement Officers, Bill of Rights, Lieutenant Malone?
Correct.
And this is a copy that you provided to Mr. Goins along with the notice of the investigation, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Could turn the page a few more times until you reach a document up at the top entitled Garrity Warning, sir.
Yes, sir.
You see that?
I do.
Okay. And is this also the Garrity Warnings that were provided to Mr. Goins as part of the investigation when you notified him of the investigation, sir?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to move City Exhibit 4 into evidence.
No objection.
Exhibit 4 in the city's notebook is admitted to evidence as Exhibit 4.
So, Lieutenant Malone, what's your understanding of what it was that you were meant to investigate with respect to Mr. Goins?
What it was that it was reasonable while investigating?
Yes, sir.
There was some discrepancies when I first reviewed the video as far as what was being said to the defendant, the subject at the time, compared to what Officer Goins was saying.
Okay. And is that also true of Officer LaFleur?
Yes.
Okay. So you were investigating both of them as part of the same investigation, sir?
Correct.
Okay. And did you have to review any information and materials to prepare yourself for the investigation?
I did.
And to the best of your memory, what information or materials did you have to review?
Body cameras, each officer, the affidavit, which is the charge of himself and someone's affidavit, supplementary reports.
Okay. And you said the videos, is that the video from the arrest from Mr. LaFleur as well as from Mr. Goins?
Correct.
Okay. Okay. And you just said that one of the things that you reviewed was the arresting affidavit?
That's correct.
You actually turn to City Tab 6, please. You flip to the second page, sir, which is says that it's a Seventh Judicial Circuit charging affidavit in the top left corner. Do you see that, sir?
I do.
Right. Is this the charging affidavit that you were talking about that you reviewed?
Yes, sir.
And this is the affidavit that you reviewed that you said it was your understanding there might have been some discrepancies in there versus what was actually said on the video?
Correct.
Okay, so if I take you to the affidavit, sir, there is a narrative about 60 or 70% down the page. It's in a box, and it starts with on 1-20-2019 at 0:54 hours. Do you see that?
Yes.
Okay. If you actually go down two paragraphs, do you see where it says, as I attempted to investigate the disturbance, staff appeared to be intoxicated and was being belligerent. See that, sir?
Yes.
And it says, staff did not obey my lawful verbal commands and was argumentative. Do you see that, sir?
I do.
Okay. Is that one of the discrepancies that you were talking about earlier, sir?
It was.
Okay. Can you describe that a little bit for me, sir?
When we watched the, when I watched the video, I didn't. It basically states here that the subject was actually being belligerent, intoxicated. But when you actually watch the video, it was totally opposite. I was just asking a question as to what happened, but he wasn't being belligerent.
Okay. And you interviewed former officer LaFleur as part of your investigation, correct?
I did.
And he actually admitted under oath during the testimony that his charging affidavit with respect to what you and I were just talking about was incorrect, right?
That's correct. Okay.
Actually, if you can, you could flip to City Tab 7, sir. Sir, do you recognize this document?
I do.
And what do you recognize this document to be?
Transcripts.
And the transcript, particularly of your interviews with Officer LaFleur?
Correct.
Okay. And who prepares these transcripts, sir?
It's going to be Rebecca Ackerman.
And do you know what her title is?
She is the administrative coordinator, I'm saying.
Okay. And she prepares this based on an audio recording from the interviews?
Yes.
Okay. This time I'd like to move Exhibit 7, City Exhibit 7, into evidence, the transcripts of interviews with Austin LaFleur.
Yes, Mr. Finnegan, our objection is that this is irrelevant. Officer LaFleur is not a subject of these proceedings. He was a probationary officer. He had no right, no ability to contest the termination. Remember I said in my opening that it'd be a red herring to look into anything of what Officer LaFleur perceived or thought. We're here about what Officer Goins saw and perceived. He didn't even write the charging affidavit that we just went over. So we object that this is irrelevant, and to the extent it could even be prejudicial for any conclusions that are drawn based on the testimony of Officer LaFleur towards Officer Goins.
Mr. DeRozier, what's the point of entering Mr. LaFleur's transcript of his interview with Lieutenant Milan?
Sure, so
based on what Mr. Wilson just said?
First of all, what I would say is this is sworn testimony under oath. It's not some just recorded interview that wasn't under oath. It was part of the same investigation that involved Mr. Goins. They were both being investigated for the same thing. They're both alleging that this gentleman was under arrest for resisting without violence, and the testimony from Mr. LaFleur has already been cited by Mr. Wilson in his questioning of Mr. Goins earlier. He asked him plenty of questions about what LaFleur said and what he didn't say. Some of the questions that he asked is stuff that was specifically referenced in this internal affairs investigation, not on the video. So it's already been brought into question here today.
If I may, Mr.
No, Mr. Wilson, I'm going to allow it. I'll let you ask some questions, but not a lot, because I don't want to get distracted with LaFleur's affidavit. And I'll give it the way it deserves and consistent with what I said in my opening. My leanings are toward admitting all evidence that you offer to me rather than excluding anything. I want to give everybody the full opportunity to put everything in that they want. So with that said, go ahead.
Your understanding that both Mr. LaFleur and Mr. Goins were alleging that by the time Mr. Goins got on the scene, Mr. Staff was already under arrest for resisting without violence.
Can you repeat that again?
Sure. So is it your understanding in the course of your investigation that both Mr. LaFleur and Mr. Goins were alleging that by the time Mr. Goins arrived on the scene, Mr. Staff was already under arrest?
Yes.
Okay. And do you know what it was they're alleging he was under arrest for?
Resisting.
Okay. And that's resisting an officer without violence?
Without violence, correct.
Does that have to be resisting arrest without violence?
That's what it is, resisting arrest without violence.
And so it can't be, I'm trying to give you a lawful command and you're not following my commands even though I'm not necessarily trying to arrest you? So do you recall, I guess I'll limit my questions about Mr. LaFleur to this. Do you recall what it was that Mr. LaFleur alleges he arrested, what specific act it was that he alleges staff engaged in that he arrested?
He gave a comment on the fact that the guy was actually being belligerent, the fact that he actually pulled away from him.
Okay, so I'd like to play just a quick clip from Mr. LaFleur's video. To see if we can identify what it was that he was saying constituted the resisting act, and then I'll move on from issues with respect to this.
Okay, so
you stated that you watched the BWC videos from Mr. LaFleur and from Mr. Jones, all right?
I have.
You did it as part of the investigation?
Correct.
Did you do it to prepare for today's testimony?
I did.
So at some point, you had to ask Mr. Goins why it was that he believed that Mr. Staff was under arrest when he arrived. And do you recall what it was that he told him?
Yes, sir.
And what was that?
He basically stated that he actually witnessed the assistant.
To verify that defense by Mr. Goins?
I did actually recreate the scene.
And when you say you recreated the scene, what does that mean?
So I went out to the to Woodland Boulevard, to the location where the arrest took place, which is 208 North Woodland Boulevard. And I actually, at the time, I used Officer Vasquez. So what we did is I actually parked the car right at the more or less the approximate location. location where you see Officer Ford's vehicle. And I had Officer Vasquez stand by the tow vehicle. And I drove back down towards Howard. He turned back around, started driving towards Woodland Boulevard. I'm heading northbound on Woodland Boulevard. To try to see where I can get a good visual on Officer Vasquez. Doing so, we activated both the LED lights, emergency lights for the tow vehicle that Officer Vasquez is actually operating, and my tow car as well. I started traveling northbound, and we marked 142 North Woodland Boulevard as a location where I kind of started seeing more or less a silhouette of Officer Vasquez.
Okay, so 142 North Woodland to 208 North Woodland, that is the approximate distance where you said you can see a silhouette of Officer Vasquez?
Correct.
Okay. If we're using the intersection of Rich Avenue as our reference point, how close to Rich Avenue is 142 North Woodland?
Couple businesses.
Okay. So it's only two or three buildings over from the intersection, you're saying?
Yes, sir.
If you had to guess how many feet that is, to the extent that you could give an educated guess, what would that be?
From 142 to Richard.
From 142 to 208, sir.
208, to about 100.
Okay. And so from about 190 feet, that's when you were able to see a silhouette of Officer Vasquez?
Correct.
Was Officer Vasquez standing still when you were conducting this experiment?
He was actually waving his hands. Above his head.
And had you asked him to wave his hands?
I did.
Did you ask him specifically to wave his hands or to do something?
I just told him to do something.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
And what was the reason for asking him to do something?
Again, because I couldn't see him. I couldn't see exactly what he was doing at 142.
Okay.
I could see that standing up there, but I just couldn't see exactly what he was doing.
Okay. And so did you go out any further from 142? Did you head backwards towards Indiana and try it from there?
Well, the way I started off on Indiana. I headed north on Indiana. And again, I chose 142 because that's the point that I was able to visually see a silhouette. So I stopped my patrol vehicle at the address of 142, saying that's where I can actually see the silhouette.
Okay. And from 142, is it your opinion that you might be able to make out whether two people were struggling such that you could see an act of resisting without violence?
No, sir.
So it's your testimony you'd have to be closer than that to see that, in your opinion?
In my opinion, yes, sir.
Okay. What time of day did you do this experiment?
I did this at about approximately 5 o'clock in the morning.
Do you remember around what time of the year it was? Tried to get as close as you could to recreating the event, but you couldn't make it rain, right, sir?
Correct.
Okay. I don't mean that to be sarcastic, but it's, you know, otherwise we'd have to wait for a rainy day, right?
Yes.
But it's your testimony that despite it not being raining, and from only a distance of under 200 feet, you still wouldn't have been able to make out what Officer Vasquez was doing even if he was waving his hands, correct?
Correct.
So if we went all the way back to the intersection at Indiana and Woodland, do you think you could see from there, sir?
Absolutely.
Objection. It's cause for speculation.
He conducted the experiment. Yeah.
But he just took the distance further back and he said, do you think you could have seen it from there?
What's your objection?
My objection is a speculation. He didn't say he did an observation from there. He just asked him, if you had done it, do you think you could have?
Your response?
Yeah, I'm not asking him if that's fact. I'm just asking him in his opinion based on conducting an experiment and from that distance he thinks he could have seen.
But he didn't do that, did he?
Well, I think that his testimony is he started from further back.
Okay, I'll sustain the objection. He's already testified what he saw from the distance of 190 feet, and you're trying to take it back further. I don't think I need that.
Okay, so when you conducted this experiment, sir, was it you of your own volition that questioned whether or not Mr. Goins' defense was valid or credible, being able to see resisting without violence?
It was not.
Do you know how that originated?
I actually, when I completed my my synopsis with both Officer McFlure at the time and Officer Goins at the time, I actually turned it into my supervisor, which at the time was Gary Back, Deputy Chief Gary Back. I asked him if there was any questions he had for me, at which point he pointed out that how was it that Officer McFlure was able to see what he said he saw based on the BWC. I missed that part as I was reviewing the initial investigation. I missed that part of the BWC, which he pointed out to me. Obviously, he had some questions that I couldn't answer, so I had to go back.
So when you drafted your initial synopsis, the only evidence that you had with respect to, or the only evidence that you had looked into with respect to Mr. Goins' allegation that he could see some act of resisting was his own testimony, right?
That's what he's talking about.
Okay, but Deputy Chief Batten questioned whether or not it was possible that Mr. Goins could have seen something like that, sir?
Correct.
Okay, and how did you feel when you realized that you had missed looking into that?
Well, obviously, like anyone would feel. You know, obviously, I couldn't answer those questions, so I could see that at the time when you presented that to me, that it was obvious that it was almost impossible to be able to witness what he said to witness.
Okay, and then it was after you had this conversation with the deputy chief that you conducted this, you know, approximation or recreation that we just talked about?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and after you had done that, did you change your conclusions about the defense that Mr. Goins had provided you?
Absolutely.
Okay. Can you tell the arbitrator about that, please?
Just the fact that when I recreated the scene, he basically claimed that he actually got to witness the pulling when Officer McFlure initially made contact with the subject. It was obvious that he was nowhere close to the location in order for him to be able to witness it. So that's a question.
Okay. And when you say nowhere close, do you know where the closest is that he possibly could have been?
Indiana, at the most, you could see the LED lights, but you couldn't see the patrol car itself.
And by that time that he was at Indiana, Mr. LaFleur and Mr. Staff had already walked away from the Boulevard car, correct?
That's right.
And they were already in that little recessed alcove area?
Yes, sir.
And that's when Mr. LaFleur had finished handcuffing Mr. Staff, correct?
Correct.
Now, so at that point, sir, did you come to the conclusion that it was either possible or unlikely that Mr. Goins had seen what he says
at
that he saw?
At the time, I thought that it was unlikely for him to have a witness. He said he was, which is the reason why I turned back out.
Okay. And if Mr. Goins wasn't able to see what he says that he saw or didn't see it, does that then change essentially the rest of the investigation?
It does.
How so?
Because now we have an individual that stated that during our initial interview that he had actually witnessed an incident, and it's the reason why he actually went into the subject's pockets, which would have given him the reason because I'm certain. But in this case, we've seen in his body cam that he was nowhere to be close, it would have given him the right to go into the person's pockets if he had been witnessed. How is it that he was actually searching the subject?
So he either could have said that he made a mistake and it was a bad search, or he could have done what he said, that he what he could have done, what he did, which is tell you that, no, this was a good search because I assumed that he was under arrest, correct?
Correct.
But he didn't say that this was a bad search, did he?
He did not.
Do you recall which policies specifically you were investigating that Mr. Goins was alleged to have violated?
Truthfulness, investigation.
I guess
conduct on becoming.
Okay.
Unlawful search. Code of conduct.
So let's actually go to your IA report, if that's all right with you, sir. It's at tab 5 in the city's book. See that first page, sir?
I do.
Okay, and about halfway down through the bottom, it lists the various policies that you were tasked with investigating, correct, sir?
Correct.
And you would review this page. Can you please let me know if, to the best of your memory, those are the policies that you were tasked with investigating?
Let's do
that. Okay. And actually, if you flip to page 2 of that, it looks like there's one more. See that, sir?
I do.
To the best of your memory, is that another one of the policies that you were tasked with violating? With investigating, sir?
Yes.
Okay. So I want to go through some of these individually, sir. Go back to the first page where it says DPD policy section 1.2.1. It says members and employees shall not engage in any conduct which constitutes a collective duty, conduct unbecoming of a member or employee, or any act which is likely to adversely affect the discipline, good order, or reputation of the department. See that, sir?
I do.
Do you know which specific conduct we've been talking about today?
Meetings.
That's for dishonesty 1.2.1, sir?
Mm-hmm.